We were looking at ring oscillators. We saw a variety of possibilities, and they're sort of close to each other except the differential pair. But because of the small supply voltage these days, the more popular alternative is to make them using CMOS inverters, either a voltage bias inverter, that is, you just have as a regular CMOS inverter where you control the frequency using the supply voltage, or a current starved inverter where you have extra devices on top of the PMOS on the bottom of the NMOS, and by varying the current you vary the frequency. Okay. Now, as I mentioned, especially in the voltage control case, as you reduce the supply voltage, so this is the control voltage. For a small control voltage, the swing here will be also small, and you have to change that to a full rail supply from 0 to VDD so that you can clock the other stages effectively. So this has to be supplied by VDD. How would you make this buffer? Yeah, one is, of course, you can just use inverters, which is let me just show one inverter, which is supplied from VDD, and this goes from 0 to V control. Do you see any problems here? So basically here what happens is that this is at VDD and this is 0 is okay, right? The NMOS will be off and the PMOS will be on. By the way, at very high frequencies, these inverters will not be, these transistors will not be completely on and off. It will not give you those rectangular waveforms that you expect. But still, if this is at 0, this is off and that is on. Whereas, if this is at V control, which is smaller than VDD, the PMOS will still be on, it won't turn off. Okay. Okay. So, this power dissipation can be quite a lot because the input swing is not adequate. Okay. Now, in general, this problem occurs whenever you go from a low supply voltage to a high supply voltage. Now, when you have data, there is a difference here. Here, this is an oscillator, so we expect a periodic waveform. Okay. The same thing can happen with in other cases also. Like for instance, inside the chip, you could be using 1.2 volt supply, whereas the IO runs at 2.5 or 3.3. So you have these level translators. In those cases, what you end up doing is, let us say this goes from 0 to V low, that is, at the input this is logic 0 and this is logic 1. But you do not want a situation like this, because if V control is much smaller than VDD, right, then this will be drawing a lot of current in both the states. So that will be terrible. So what is done is something like this. This is VDD, and these transistors and this inverter have to be sized correctly. But if you do that, what happens is, when it is 0, of course, this is off and this will get pulled up to VDD. When it is V low, this will start drawing current. Okay, as it starts lowering this voltage goes high here and then it turns off this PMOS. So, even in that case, the current here will be 0 in steady state. Okay. So, that is what is used for level translation. Okay. So, if you have data, you can use this. what happens. So you could use something like this also. Now of course you actually don't need this. This is required for random data, that is when the inputs can be anything and there could even be a long string of ones and so on. In our case, because we have periodic data, we can do something simpler. I mean periodic signal, because we are looking at an oscillation, right, a clock. So, one of the possible ways is to use AC coupling, because it is periodic you can use AC coupling. So, you use some CC and this is some high resistance. What happens if you connect the output and input of a CMOS inverter through a high resistance? What will be the bias voltage here? It will be the self bias voltage of the inverter. So, it will be biased in the, this is the characteristic of the inverter, VOVI, and it will get biased here. So, it is biased in the high gain region and of course, it will be drawing current because it is biased there, but it is biased near where it is most sensitive, right. So, even if this swing is smaller than VDD, this will amplify it and then the output swing can reach VDD. And if with one inverter you cannot do it, you can use a few of them. This is a standard way of making buffers for VCOs. You can use any of these things. Which one? Here? Yeah. This goes from high to low. So, basically this was 0 and because this current goes to 0 when it goes from high to low, right. So, this voltage will start rising up. Let us see what happens if this goes from high to low. Yeah, if it keeps at 1, it looks like there is a deadlock, or am I missing something here in this circuit? Or perhaps there has to be, let me again look this up. There could be something like this which will raise it slightly, right. I mean essentially this is an inverter which is operating from the low supply voltage. So, this will turn off when VI is equal to V low and when VI is 0, this will start raising that, and once it starts raising that, this latch can take over and then do the rest. I think that is probably required, okay. Yeah, you are right. I mean, if we do not have anything, then it is possible that VO stays at 0, the output of the inverter stays at 1 and nothing moves, right. Thanks. Actually, first of all, I wrote VO lowered, it should be VO increased sufficiently to M2 prime. Okay. Oh, no, no, sorry, sorry. This is correct, this was correct actually. Here, when VI becomes 0, VO raised by M2 prime to trigger I1, okay. So, in general with any oscillator, you need a buffer because you will be driving a lot of load and you need to have the buffer. It is also important that the VCO should not be affected by the load, okay. Like you make a VCO, it will be oscillating at some frequency, you connect the load, its frequency will change. You certainly do not want this, right, because something is clocking and this frequency changes. So the buffer also protects the VCO from the load affecting its frequency. Okay. So these ring oscillators and buffers are conceptually simple circuits, but you optimize the simulation, you do a careful layout so that you don't have parasitics and things like that. Right? So you do a good design so that you don't have spurious variations in frequency and so on. Okay? One of the things you also have to make sure is you have the control voltage of the VCO, and especially in a ring oscillator the gain KVCO is quite high, okay, the gain from the control voltage to the output. So you also have to make sure that no other noise or disturbance couples to the control voltage, because anything that couples to the control voltage will also change the frequency and adds to either phase noise or spurious tones or in disturbed oscillator in some way. So the layout also has to make sure that this control node is well protected, and it should be controlled only by the thing that you intend, that is the output of the loop filter. Okay. Any questions here?
Now I won't go into the phase noise analysis at the transistor level. Now I'll show you quickly how this is done.
So this is the ring oscillator. As you know, you have so many inverters in a ring, so that the total phase shift becomes 2 pi, and then you have oscillation. Now to analyze the noise of this, that is, earlier I just showed that if each inverter has some noise, if each delay element has a noise, then the overall oscillator will have the accumulated version of that noise. But how do we calculate the phase noise, that is from the component level, right? How do you calculate the noise? So for that we use this model. This is actually a typically used model, and this is idealized, meaning what I have done is the following. I assume that there is an ideal comparator, okay, and that will trigger one of these switches. Okay, if it is high it will turn on this switch, if it is low it will turn on the other switch. So the output logically is the inverted version of this. So what happens is these current sources, when the upper switch is high it will charge the output node towards VDD, when the lower switch is high it will discharge it towards ground. And also I have assumed that these current sources are such that they will supply a constant current and the minimum voltage required across them is 0. I mean, this is an idealized version, you know that a MOS transistor current source needs some minimum voltage across it, that is the gate overdrive voltage, right, VGS minus VT. In this case I have assumed that to be 0, so that basically it becomes very easy to calculate. This node is getting charged by a constant current either all the way to VDD or all the way to ground. Okay. And you can model the noise of this current source, that is what gives you phase noise, and do the calculation. I can share these slides, if you are interested you can go through it, but what I am more interested right now is to show some fundamental relationships between the power dissipation and the phase noise.
So the waveforms look like this, right? Each waveform, for instance you consider this blue waveform, or maybe the red waveform,
okay, that is the starting one.
When the red one crosses VDD by 2 here, right, when it crosses VDD by 2 it starts the transition of the next one, and when the next one starts falling and it falls below VDD by 2 it starts the rising transition of the next one.
Okay, this is how the delay chain works. Okay,
and then depending on the number of inverters the whole cycle repeats after a certain number of waveforms. Okay, in this case I have 3 inverters, so there are 6 of these delays. And what is the delay? The delay is between, let's say, this red one crossing VDD by 2 and whichever waveform it triggers, this blue one crossing VDD by 2 in the opposite direction. That's the delay of the inverter, right? Ideally when the red one crosses VDD by 2, the other one should instantly go to 0. If there is 0 delay, now there is some delay. Okay. So, you can calculate the, you can write the expressions for the oscillation waveforms and things like that based on the number of stages, etcetera. And also you can find out how much current is drawn from the supply, right. If you look at this, from the VDD, basically it draws current only when it is rising. This you know, this is what happens in an inverter, right. When the output is rising, it draws current from the supply. When the output is falling, it dumps current into ground. So, no current is drawn from the supply. So, if you calculate the total energy per transition, it is CVDD square. This is a, gives you the familiar formula, right, CV square F. So, if you to calculate the total power dissipated in m inverters, I have assumed m stages, it will be the C m times this energy per transition times the number of transitions in every second, which is the oscillation frequency. Okay. And then what else do you have to model? You assume that these current sources have some noise, right. It should be the current, this I 1 which is going into the capacitor should be either plus minus I p, but around that it will have some wiggles like that. Because of that, this charging and discharging waveforms, right, instead of being an ideal ramp, it will also have some wiggles. And what does the wiggle do? It will shift the position at which it crosses T by 2. Okay. And there are standard ways of calculating the variance of that, and we, that is what we do. Okay. So, essentially what you do is you estimate the amount of noise at when it is supposed to cross, okay, and then that noise divided by the slope is the shift, horizontal shift. Okay. That is a standard way of calculating time shifts. And I won't go into the details, there is some standard calculation that you can do with noise, and you can find the expression. Okay. So, it turns out to be that this the phase noise has this expression, where this S naught, this is the noise spectral density of the current noise, which is charging it. Okay. So, basically you put everything together, you have the single stage delay, the oscillation period, oscillation frequency, power dissipation and so on. Okay. And for a ring oscillator, for an oscillator it is defined like this. Right, it is basically the inverse of the phase noise 1 over L of f times f naught square by f square and inversely related to power dissipation, and conventionally this has been taken in milliwatts. Okay. And typically what you see published is not just this number, but 10 log to base 10. Okay. Now, if you want to make a better oscillator, would you want a higher figure of merit or a lower figure of merit? I mean, would the figure of merit be higher or lower if the oscillator is better designed? Higher in this case, right. So, if for the same power dissipation you achieve lower phase noise, this figure of merit will be higher. Similarly, if for the same phase noise you consume lower power, this will be higher. And also this offset frequency appears, right. If you achieve the same phase noise at a lower offset frequency, then also the figure of merit is higher. Okay. That is the same thing. Basically, if let us say L of f versus f, for one oscillator it is like this, at 1 megahertz you achieve minus 100 dBc per hertz. And you have a second oscillator which achieves minus 100 dBc per hertz at 100 kilohertz. Obviously, this is a better oscillator than the other one, right. So, that also is taken into account, because you have to say what the phase noise is and what at what frequency that is, okay. And also, if with the same power dissipation you achieve the same phase noise at the same offset, but the oscillator is running at a higher frequency, that is also a better design, okay. In fact, typically if you do not do anything, if you design an oscillator at a higher frequency with the same power dissipation, it will also have worse phase noise at the same frequency, okay. Now, this figure of merit, right, I did not derive this here, but you remember the figure of merit of the RC filter, it was that power dissipation divided by the signal to noise ratio times bandwidth, right. Now, this is not some arbitrary figure of merit, we did not put like bad things in the numerator, good things in the denominator and say that hey, this is figure of merit. This came from some fundamental calculations, right, because for in the idealized calculations, this is proportional to kt, right, it was 2 pi kt or something like that. So, these things actually are exactly proportional, they can be traded off with each other. Similarly, this figure of merit also comes from fundamental calculations, okay. So, you can see this is the expression for the figure of merit. So, you have 1 by kt in the denominator, I mean this figure of merit is defined in an inverse way to the other one, the other the for the filter, the way we define the figure of merit, the lower it is the better it is, right. If we had defined it as the inverse, the higher it would be similar to this. So, here it is inversely proportional to kt, which is just fundamental constants and absolute temperature, and it is also now you have Vgs minus Vt divided by Vdd. This is basically not a fundamental constant, but something related to the design. On the other hand, in a low voltage design, you do not have too much freedom to change this either, okay. It basically says that if you use smaller devices and make it oscillate at a given frequency, it will have higher Vgs minus Vt and lesser noise, so that is better, right. So, because the higher the Vgs minus Vt, the higher the figure of merit. This 10 to the minus 3 comes only because this power dissipation is taken in milliwatts, that is all, there is nothing mysterious about that. If you take it in watts, that would not be there. Okay. So, these expressions will let you roughly calculate what you expect, what to expect from a ring oscillator, okay. Now, if you go to LC oscillators, again the conceptual schematic is just this, you have a lossy LC tank and you have a negative resistance, okay. Now, in general you are not going to put a linear negative resistance like this, the picture really is we have a transconductor GM. And we connect them in positive feedback, okay. That is how you make the negative resistance. And this transconductance, if you look at its I out versus VI characteristics, okay, it will be like this, and it will have some maximum current typically, okay. Now, of course, in reality it would not even be piecewise straight lines, it will have some curved shape. And it turns out in case of CMOS technology, the most popular version of this is you have an inductor with a center tap which you connect to the supply and you have a capacitor. And I mean this includes the loss, this R is not of course explicitly placed there. You have I naught. So, you have this differential pair, it creates a differential transconductance and you connected that in positive feedback. So, it behaves more or less like this, except that the actual thing will be more curved. it will also get limited to I naught, because the maximum current that can be supplied from either transistor equals I naught. Okay. And to vary the frequency of this, you take this capacitor and you can use varactors. Okay. This is the control. You know what a varactor is? It's either a reverse bias PN junction diode or a MOS capacitor. It can be used as a varactor. And again, the most popular one is a MOS varactor. I'll describe how that is made. Okay. This is, I mean, you have to be able to vary the frequency, right? An LC oscillator, you have to vary either the L or the C to vary the frequency, and it's a lot easier to change the capacitance than the inductance. Okay. And I mean, you don't have only the variable component, you also have some fixed capacitor. Okay. Because the total capacitance should be such that you have the oscillation at the right frequency, and the variable part will give you the range of frequency variation. Okay. And typically, if you want to make this vary over a wide range, you can't do it with only varactors, because the varactors will change their capacitance, but not by some huge factor, right? The varactor's capacitance may change by a factor of 2 or something like that, some relatively small factor. You also have a bank of capacitors with switches. Okay, these are fixed capacitors, but you can, if you turn the switch on, it will appear across the LC tank. If you turn it off, it will not appear across the LC tank. You have a whole bunch of these. Okay, and these are controlled by digital bits. So, let us say B0 to Bn minus 1, and they could be binary weighted and so on. So, so this gives you basically these fixed capacitors with switches give you a capacitance variation in discrete steps, and this varactor gives you a continuous variation. Okay. So when you make a clock and data recovery circuit, the output of the loop filter appears at this node. This is the control voltage, right? As the control voltage is changing, the frequency will change. But what happens is, when you make this LC oscillator, LC oscillator will not be as widely tunable as a ring oscillator. Ring oscillator's frequency can be very widely tunable, whereas an LC oscillator, what happens is the amount of capacitance change you get is limited with whatever, even with this discrete switching and so on. Okay, because you remember, we can't vary the inductor, and to change the frequency by a factor of 2, what is the factor by which you have to change the capacitance? Factor of 4. That's actually quite difficult because of all the parasitics that come in, because everything that you connect here, right, also contributes to parasitics from either node, and on top of it you have the transistor parasitics as well, and these things also appear across the LC tank. So, because of all this, you can't change the capacitance by such a huge factor. It is actually very, very difficult to get a tuning range by a factor of 2. Okay. So, but the good thing is that the inductance does not suffer much process variation. And capacitance also, it suffers a little more, but not that much. Whereas, a ring oscillator, right, the transistors have huge process variations. There, the in a ring oscillator, the oscillation frequency is dependent on the transistor speed, whereas here it is L and C values. So, if you want to let us say cover a particular frequency, 10 gigahertz, like let us say plus minus a few percent, a ring oscillator, if you make the ring oscillator and don't do any, I mean, don't make any particular arrangements, and then you vary the process and temperature corners, its frequency will vary by a huge amount, whereas an LC doesn't vary that much. So if you want to target a particular frequency, you don't need so much variation in the LC oscillator, right? You don't need that much tuning in the frequency. Okay. So typically you get maybe plus minus 25% or something, and that's enough to cover a particular frequency. But if you are targeting a wide range of frequencies, it's a lot more difficult to do with an LC oscillator than with a ring oscillator. Okay. So we'll continue from here. Let me clean up the formulas. I am not sure where the error has crept in, but then we'll also discuss the figure of merit of the LC oscillator and see that from the fundamental figure of merit, right? You'll see that the LC oscillator is much better than the ring oscillator, and the higher the quality factor of the tank, the L and C, the better it is. And this kind of makes sense. If your L and C had no loss at all, you don't have any noise because there is no resistance, and you don't have any compensating negative resistance either. So basically, it'll have zero phase noise. Of course, we don't have Q of infinity, but the quality factor that you have will contribute to reducing the phase noise.